taking a look at chapter 5. And what we're going to be looking at in chapter 5 is what's called solving systems of equations. And so I'll talk about what a system is called and then how you solve it. So as I said to you before, we're going to spend most of the rest of the term on this type of topic, okay, solving what are called systems. Now, there's many ways we can solve systems. In this class, we don't even look at all the ways you can do it. There's actually a way you can solve systems pretty quickly using this kind of calculator. But we used this before when we used it to find like a line of best fit. We're not going to use this calculator for this talk, although it is really, really handy to use it. It's just not something in Algebra 1 to do. So we're going to look at three ways. Two of them we're going to learn this week. One of them we're going to wait because there's a little bit more to it. So it's better to do that one a different week. So we're going to look at two out of the three. Today, the method I'm going to show you is graph. And that is one way to solve a system. So first of all, what is a system? Well, a system is basically when you draw the way we're going to do it today, it's when you draw two pictures at the same time and you look at where they cross. Okay, I'll put that right back up. Now, pictures can be, actually I'll do it on this one. Pictures can be a lot more complicated than lines. There's an example. Must have just been something I did last week. This could be thought of as a system. And there are places where these two graphs cross. There's one spot right there. There's one spot right there. And the calculator can actually tell me where they cross automatically. And that's what it's telling me right here. Now, those graphs are more complicated because they're curved. We're going to look at graphs that look like this. Straight lines. So generally, when you draw two straight lines, they can only cross once, right here. There is a way they could never cross, and that's if you do two lines like this. Does anybody remember what these kinds of lines are called? Yep. Parallel. So that's kind of a special case. If you draw two lines that are parallel, they never cross. But in general, two lines, when you draw them that are not parallel, and not right on top of each other, will only cross once. Curves can cross many, many times. Curves get a lot more complicated. That's why we're looking at lines, linear, okay, straight lines. So in the blank, you guys want to fill in the bold, it says a system of linear equations is a set of. And then, do you guys have the part that's already after the bold written down on the printed? Okay. Now, it's a set, it says of two or more. We're only going to be doing two, but you can do more than two. Okay, we're going to look at just two. So it's a set of two or more lines, and the equations that you graph have to use the same variables. So for example, if you write one equation, like y equals 2x plus 5, then the other equation you write also has to use x and y. You can't switch to like using a and b. So it's two equations, and each equation has the same letters. Usually x and y is what we use. The big difference with solving a system is you need to solve for two variables. You don't have that printed on your guided notes, so you need to write in the two. Okay, it's the blank, it's the third line, and it's the blank right at the beginning. So we have to solve for two variables. Compare that to like something like this. If I wrote this equation down and I said solve, anybody tell me what are you solving for? in that equation? Yeah?
On for x.
You're solving for x. Is there any other letter in that equation? No. So the only thing you're solving for here is x. So when you're done, your answer would look like this. X equals, and then you'd have a number in that box. Well, this week, the answers are going to look like this. You're going to have two letters in the box. So when we write our answers, we have to solve for two letters, not just one. All right, so let's see if we could come up with an example of a system of linear equations. Can somebody give me an equation of a line in the format that we just talked about that we like, number y equals mx plus b, but can somebody give me an example of an equation of a line? Plus 3. Okay, so there's one. And now for it to be a system, I need 2. So there's one. Can somebody give me another equation? Yeah?
Y equals 2x plus 9.
2x plus 9. Now, just to show you quickly, let me draw both of those. So the calculator can automatically sketch these for me as long as I type in the slope and the y-intercept. You don't have to know how to do it. We're going to sketch by hand. But this one, I just want to sketch it quick. All right, so 2x plus 9. Now, what's going to happen is the lines are going to probably go off the screen because the 6x is very steep. So I'm trying to find where they cross. In this case, it goes off the screen. But I can adjust my screen to be bigger so I can see that. Let me draw the two lines again. Right, there's the one that's really steep. And there's the second one. Yep, we got it. So when we do a problem like this, the goal would be to find where those two lines cross. Now, most likely, because I just had you guys make this one up, they probably don't cross at a nice spot. Well, actually, it's not that bad. They cross at 1.5 for the x and 12 for the y. So these would be the two numbers that we need to figure out by hand. Now, if you didn't have a calculator and you just drew two lines by hand, can anybody think what might be difficult about figuring out that number if you graph it by hand? What would make this number maybe a little bit tough to figure out? Maybe not this y value so much, but the x value could be a little tough. Oh, come, what's tough about the x value? Yeah?
It's not a certain point.
Right, it's halfway in between. So halfway in between isn't awful to try to figure out, but when you draw by hand, if the answer doesn't come out to a nice number, then it can be really hard to figure out. Like, let me just mess this graph up a little bit. So the answer doesn't come out even as nice as it just did there. Okay, so I just changed one of the y-intercepts a little bit. Now, let me do second calc intercept, and let me show you where they cross this time. Now, that's exactly where they cross. You are never going to be able to figure out that number by graphing it by hand. I mean, how are you going to graph something on graph paper and tell that it crosses at 1.45? That's too precise. All right, so that's one downside to graphing. If you have a problem and the answer doesn't come out to a nice number, like 3, 4, 5, it's going to be very, very hard to figure out decimals. So when we do graphing, the answers are going to come out to nice numbers. Especially even this one, even though it's only one decimal place, how are you going to graph and tell that something's at 11.9? I mean, especially when you're just doing it by hand. You're not going to be able to tell that. Think about a graphing calculator, yeah. So that's where the calculator comes in handy. There you go. That's an example of a system. All right, so the next blank that you guys need to fill in, it says A, and you want to fill this in. says a solution of a system of linear equations is basically two numbers. So if I was doing like a calculator problem, I could write my answer exactly like that. Say x equals, write the number, y equals, and then write the number. That's how the calculator does it. But a lot of times what we're going to do is we have a name for an x and a y value when we put them together. That's called an ordered pair. What's another name for an ordered pair? No, yeah, a coordinate. So you have two numbers you need to write as your answer, which in this section you do. You can write your answer as a coordinate. In the case of this one up above, you could write 1.45, comma, 11.9. As I've already said to you, your numbers are going to be nicer than that. But that is another way you can write your answer. X, comma, Y. Or you can write X equals and Y equals separately. But this means that. It's the same thing. Right, so you might see me do it both ways. But the important thing when you write the answer, you've got to have two answers. If you only write one number, you've only done half the problem. So you have to write both of these numbers. Now, the first thing we're going to do is similar to the warm-up. What I'm going to do is I'm going to give you some numbers, and I'm going to ask you, is what I gave you the answer to the problem? So you don't even have to figure out how I got these numbers at this point. I'm just going to give you some numbers and say, tell me if they're the solution to the system. And to figure out if they're the solution, this is how you do it. You have to plug them in. You take whatever I give you and you plug it in. What do you plug it into? I'm going to give you that too. I'm going to give you a formula. And the goal, when you plug the numbers in, is to end up with a true statement. What's a true statement? Something like this. When you plug it in, you end up with an equation that has the same number on the left and the same number on the right. If you don't have the same number on the left and the right, then you have a false statement, which means one of two things. Either you made a mistake, or whatever I gave you is not the answer to the problem. So that's what goes on that last blank line on your guided notes. Plug the ordered pair into the formula, into the equation I give you, and see if you get a true statement. So for this part, there's no graph. You don't have to graph it. The next part is when we have to do the graph. So this is basically how you check your answer. That's what this is. Once you get an answer, you plug it back in to see if it works. All right, so first example, I think there's three of this type. It says to tell whether the ordered pair is a solution to the system. So what am I about to give you? I'm going to give you a system. That means I'm going to give you two different equations, and I'm going to give you a coordinate. There's the first one. This is the system. This is what I'm saying might be the answer to it. We need to check it. Now remember, when you check it, you have to take these two numbers and fill them in to each equation. You can't just pick one of them. You have to fill them in to each equation. So let's start with the top. x plus y equals 7. What number, based on looking at the coordinate that I'm pointing to with the arrow, what number do they want me to fill in for x?
2.
Yes. What number do they want me to fill in for y? Yeah?
5.
Yes. So take the 2 and the 5, and let's start with the top equation. So x is 2, so change it to 2. Y is 5, so change it to 5. And then equals 7. Now we simplify it and see if we get something that is true. What does 2 plus 5 give me? 8?
7.
I get 7 equals 7. Is that true? Go ahead.
Yes.
What that means is that this coordinate works in the top equation. Are we done? What else do we have to check? Yeah? It has to work in the bottom. If it doesn't work in the bottom, then the answer here is no. That's not a solution. It has to work in both. Okay, so now let's do the bottom. So we're going to have a 2. Leave room for what we're going to change x to. We're going to put a minus. We're going to put 3. Okay, leave room next to the 3 because you're going to change the y. And then put negative 11 on the other side. Let's start with what's going to go right after the 2. It was an x. What are we changing x to? Yeah, 2. That's my x. And right after the 3 was the y. What are we changing y to? Yeah,
5.
That's my y. Now, we need to do that out and see if we get negative 11. If we do, that's good. If we don't, then we're going to write that that's not the solution. All right, so let's check. 2 times 2, Brady, gives me?
4.
And Emily, 3 times 5 gives me? 15. So now I have 4 minus 15 equals negative 11. Well, let's check. So 4 minus 15 gives me negative 11. Is that equation that I just ended up with true? Yeah. What would be something that's not true? I don't know. Negative 11 equals 0. That's not true. Okay. So since this equation worked in the top one, and it worked, or this point worked in the top equation, and it worked in the bottom equation, is this ordered pair the solution? Yes. So, yes, 2 comma 5 is the solution. So what that means is if I took my graphing calculator and I typed both of these in and I graphed it, they would cross on the screen at exactly 2 comma 5. This point is where the two lines cross. That's what we just figured out. Now, how would you get the 2 and the 5 if they didn't give it to you? That's what we're going to do in the next step. But for now, you don't have to worry how they got the 2 and the 5. Pretend like this was somebody else's work, and you're just checking their answer to see if they got the right one. All right, let's try B. Okay, so the point they're giving me is negative 2, 0. And then below that is the system of equations. So the first step is just identify what they gave you for x and what they gave you for y. What did they give me for x in this case? Yep. Negative 2. What did they give me for y? Yep. 0. So we're going to take the negative 2 and the 0 and we're going to fill them into each equation. Let's start with the top. If I fill in for y, what's going to be on the left side where I just highlighted? That's going to turn into, yep, that's going to turn into a zero. And then I copy down everything else except what I'm going to fill in for. So I'm going to fill in now for x. How about, Alyssa, what am I going to fill in for the right after the negative 2? Yeah, and what are we filling in for x in this time? Can you say it again? Negative 2. So just a coincidence, this is a negative 2 and that's a negative 2, not the best example. But we are filling in a negative 2 for the x. Now let's do this out. Negative 2 times negative 2. How about, Dorian, what's negative 2 times negative 2? 4. And can you finish up that right-hand side for me?
0.
Okay. Did I end up with a statement that was true? What do you think, Michael?
Yes.
Yes, I did. So, are we done checking if this answer is the solution to this system? It worked in the top one. So are we all set? No, what else do we have to do? I gotta check the bottom one. Maybe it doesn't work in the bottom one. Let's see what happens. Okay, let's see, I'm gonna do the bottom one right here. So y, we're gonna change to 0, equals. Put down your negative, because that's what was in the formula. And I always put what I'm plugging in parentheses. That way I just know I leave a space for it. So we got 0 here. The negative is from the formula. And what number is going to go inside these parentheses? Because it's taking the place of what I, well, taking the place of what's right after my cursor.
Yeah?
Negative 2. Okay, so we get 0 equals negative negative 2 plus 4. What's negative negative 2? Yeah?
Positive
2. Positive 2. And what's 2 plus 4? 6. 0 equals 6. Is that a true statement? 0 equals 6. No, that's not true. So now, is this coordinate the solution to this system? What do you think? John, what do you think? No, that's not the solution. You might say, well, yeah, but it worked in the top one. Yeah, but it didn't work in the bottom one. It has to work in both. So if it doesn't work in one of them, then you're done. Which, if it doesn't work in the top one, do you even need to check the bottom one? What do you think? Right, it has to work in both. So if you check the top one and it doesn't work, well, then you can stop. Because whether it works or not in the second one, if it doesn't work in the first one, you're done. It doesn't work. So the answer for this one is negative 2, 0 is not the solution. So negative 2, 0 is not the solution. What is the solution? Well, I don't know. It's not negative 2, 0. It's something else. All right, why don't you guys take a minute and try that. See if you can figure out if 1, 4 is the solution to this system. So I'll give people a couple minutes to try that, and then we'll take a look. All right, let's take a look. So we're going to check if 1-4 is the solution. Doesn't matter which equation you start with. I usually just start and check with the top one. Okay. So can somebody tell me, when you change the x and the y to what they tell you you should change them to, what does this top equation look like? You don't have to simplify it. Just literally change those letters to those numbers, and that's it.
Yep. 4 equals 3 parentheses 1 parentheses plus 1.
Yeah, so I like you put the 1 there. That's good, because you can't just write 3 with a 1 next to it. It's going to look like 31. So it's 4 equals 3 times 1 plus 1. So we get 4 equals. And Anaya, what's 3 times 1?
3.
3 plus 1?
4.
So we get 4 equals 4. Is that true? Yep. So that means that this could be the solution, right? It works in the first one, but we need to keep going and check the second one. All right. How about Caleb? Can you tell me, when I do the second one,
yeah,
what does that look like when we change those letters to those numbers?
So it'd be 4 equals 1, negative 1, plus 5,
so we've got negative, and then we put in our x, which is 1. So that's negative 1 plus 5. And what did you just say that was?
4.
4? Is that true?
Yes.
Yeah, it's the same thing we got up above. So if you end up with a true statement here and a true statement here, then you know it works in both. So 1-4 is the solution. Okay, let's draw those. Just to show you real quick. 3x plus 1. Negative x plus 5. And this is what those two lines look like if you draw them on the screen. There's 3x plus 1. There's the negative x plus 5. Negative has a slope that goes down to the right. And if I calculate where the two lines cross, what does the calculator tell me for where the two lines cross each other? Yeah. 1, 4, which is exactly what they gave us. So I confirmed this was also the answer by graphing it and checking it on the calculator. So any questions why that one is the solution? So this is the part that you guys are going to do by hand. We're going to actually figure out where two lines cross by drawing them. So you need to draw a pretty accurate picture, you know, use something that's straight. And it's going to come out to nice numbers. So as long as you use graph paper and you draw the line straight, you should be able to get your answer pretty good. Okay, I kind of already showed you this, but let's see if people can figure this out. So in the first example we did and the third example, we saw that the answer worked. This coordinate worked in the first one, and it worked in the second one. That means that this coordinate is on that line, and this coordinate was on that line. How can the same coordinate be on two different lines at the same time? Think about, if you draw two lines, how can the same coordinate be on two different lines at the same time? Yeah?
Is it where the two intersect?
It would have to be where the two intersect.
Yes.
So the only way that a coordinate can be on two lines at the same time, if it's where the two lines cross each other. And that's what we need to find. So you don't have to write that part down on your guided notes. But just as kind of a big picture, that's what we're doing. We're trying to draw two lines, and we're trying to find a point that works in both of them. The only point that works in both is where the lines cross. That's what you have to find. All right, so how do we solve a system by graphing? Step one. First thing is you need to make sure both of your equations are in y equals mx plus b form, and we need to graph. If your equations are not in y equals mx plus b form, that's what we practiced in the world. Okay, and again, to make this method work, you really need a couple important things. You need something that you can draw straight lines with, you can't estimate, and you need graphing. That's why I think on the homework tonight, I have a grid on there if you print it. If you don't, I have graph paper you can take when you leave in the back of the room by the TV. All right, so graph each equation. Now, as long as the two lines you draw are not parallel, they're going to cross somewhere. Wherever they cross, we're going to try to estimate that point. And then once we estimate it, we want to check and see if it works. Okay. How do you check it? That's what we just did in the first three columns. You take the coordinate that you get, plug it into both of the original equations, and see if you get a true statement. So step three is what we just practiced together. Now you're going to have to do steps one and two to figure out what the point is where they cross. Okay, so we'll try two of them, we'll do together, where I give you the equations. And then the last one we're going to try, if we get to it, is a word problem where you need to figure out the equations yourself. So that's the hardest type. But chapter 5, we need to get into some more word problems, so we kind of got to get used to doing some practice with word problems. Okay, does everybody have steps 1, 2, and 3? Yeah? Yep, just saying all of them. Okay, as far as solving a system, this is probably the easiest type because you have two equations and y is already by itself in both. So you don't have to figure out the equations. You don't even have to fix the equations to get y alone. We might have to fix the equations in some problems, but not these first two. Okay, so let's start with y equals x plus 1. We'll call that equation 1. That's equation 2. Let's start with equation 1. And the first thing you start with there is your y-intercept. Who can tell me what my y-intercept is for equation 1?
Yep. 1.
1. Where do I go to mark that on my graph?
You go up 1 on the y-intercept?
Yep, we go up 1.
On the y-axis, sorry.
Yep, up 1 on the y-axis. Perfect. Okay, I'm going to do this one in black. I'll do this one in red. They don't have to be different colors, but just to make this clear to you, I'll do one red and one black. Okay, so I've got that point. Now I need to use what's in front of the x. What do we call the number that's in front of the x again? Yeah. And that's called your
slope.
That's my slope. So the slope here is a 1, but there's no number in the bottom. To do slope, I need a fraction. Because the top number tells me up and down, the bottom number would tell me to go to the right. So what number can I put in the bottom to make that fraction?
1.
I can put it over 1. So now, from this point, my rise is 1. Which way does that tell me to go? If my rise is 1.
Yeah.
Up 1. And my run is also 1. Which way does that tell me to go? Yeah? Right. So I'm going to go up one, right one. And I'm going to do that a bunch of times. Now I can also go the other way if I want. I can go down one, left one. That's the same thing, just getting points the other way. Again, I'm doing way more points than I need. But it just helps me because the board is big to draw my line. Okay, and I said I was going to do this one in black. Okay, so that's pretty good. It's not perfect, but I think it'll be close enough. Okay, now let's do the red one. What's my y-intercept for equation number two? Negative 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. And my slope, I need to write it as a fraction. How can I write my slope in equation 2 as a fraction? Go down under. Okay, so now, from that red dot, the 3 tells me to go which way?
Yep.
Up 3. And the 1 tells me to go? So the up and down is the top number. So 3 is, we're going up 3. The bottom number is left and right. So the 1 tells me, yep,
right.
We always go to the right. So up 3, right 1. And hopefully I land right on one of those dots. So let's try it. Up 3, right 1. Up 3, right 1. Up 3, right 1. There we go. I've already found the answer. I can see where they're going to cross. But you know, you could do a couple more. And now draw that line. And I'll change it to red in a second. Probably about like that. Let's make it red. And put it right about there. So the goal was to figure out where these cross. Okay, so looking at it, anybody think they see the coordinate where they cross? Yeah.
3, 4.
3, 4. So if we plug 3 in for x, we should get 4 for y. That's what this coin tells us. Let's try it. Let's put 3 in here. What's 3 plus 1 give me? Yep, that gives me 4, so that's good. Let's check it in the bottom one. 3 times x minus 5. X is 3. What's 3 times 3? Yep, 9. And what's 9 minus 5? 4. So, yes, if you plug 3n for x in both of these equations, you do get 4 for y, which is what we were supposed to get. So that is the answer to this system, 3, 4. You can also write your answer like this. That's the same thing. Yeah? Yep, just sign up. So any questions on how we figured out where these two lines cross? Yeah. Isn't it what? 4, 4? Well, 4, 4 would be 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 4, 4 would be right there. So that's 3, 4. X equals 3, y equals 4. So, without something to draw straight lines, this method doesn't work well. And without graph paper, it doesn't work well. Okay, any questions on that? All right, let's try one more of that type we'll do together, and then we'll finish up with the word problem.
Yes.
Yeah, can you just wait for whoever just hang out to come back?
Yeah.
Now. Okay, so equation one. What do I start with when you want to graph it? Your slope or your y-intercept?
The slope?
Nope, we don't start with the slope.
The y-intercept.
The y-intercept. What's the y-intercept in equation one?
4.
Good. How do I mark that on my graph?
You place 4 on the y-axis.
Yeah, we're going to go up 4 on the y-axis. Okay, so there's your y-intercept. Now I use the slope. What's my slope in the first equation? Yeah?
1.
No, not 1. Negative 1. So for this one, my slope is negative 1, but I need it as a fraction. Yeah? Just make it negative 1 over 1. Okay. So now, from this point, which way do I go to get to my next point? My rise is negative 1, and my run is positive 1. Yeah?
Down.
Down how many?
1.
1. And then which way?
Over 1.
Which way is over?
Left.
Nope. We always go, the bottom number is always going to be positive, so we always go to the, yeah,
right.
To the right. So down 1, right 1. So down 1. Right one? And you can do it. You don't have to do it that many times. It's just because the board is so big. If I don't do it, it's hard for me to draw my line. Okay. So there's the first one. Okay, that's pretty good. And now the second one. Okay. With the second one, Jacinda, what number do I start with?
Yeah,
that's
just negative 8.
The negative 8. And how do I mark that on my graph?
On the y-axis, you go down 8 times.
Yep, go down 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. There we go. Okay, now I need my slope. What's my slope for the second equation? Preferably as a fraction, because I need the top and bottom. Yeah? 2/1. So can you tell me, Aiden, from this spot, my rise is 2, my run is 1. How do I move to get to my next point?
Move up 2
and 1 to the right. Yep, move up 2 and 1 to the right. And hopefully if I just keep doing that, I'll run right into the other line. Okay? So up 2, right 1, up 2, right 1. Up 2, right 1. Look at that. I already have my answer, so technically I can already stop. All right. But I'll draw my line just so you guys can see it. Okay, so there's your line. And looking at that, anyone think they can tell me where those lines cross? Yep.
4/1.
So you think they cross right there?
I mean, 4/0.
Yeah, 4/0. Yep. So they cross at 4/0, and that's your answer. Okay, any question on that? So in terms of solving a system, these two problems were probably like as straightforward as you can get because they gave you everything for the equations and they gave it to you with y by itself. Okay, they couldn't do any more to set that up. Okay, the last one we're going to take a look at, that's one where you need to set up the equation yourself. All right, so let's take a look. Do you guys already have this one printed? It says you sell small candles and large candles. Okay, let's just make sure all the numbers are the same. It says small candles are $4, large candles are $6, and the total $144. I think all those match up. Okay, so the first step is to set up a system. How many equations do you need to make a system? Yeah? You need two. So what we're going to be figuring out is these two equations. Now, when we write our equations, how many letters are usually in each one? Yep, two. And what are the letters we normally use? Yeah, X and Y. Let's stick with X and Y. You could use S and L for small and large. The only problem is S can kind of look like the number five, so that's not a good thing. So let's just stick with X and Y. Let's let small candles be X and large candles are Y. So it says we're selling two types of candles and we make a total of $144. How many types of candles are we selling? Yeah. Two. So we know that the money that we make from the small candles plus the money from the large candles equals, what was our total money we made from selling small candles and large candles? Yeah. It was $144. So that's basically going to be our first equation, but we need to figure out how to write, we can't write that dollar sign from small. We've got to put that in terms of numbers and letters. How much is a small candle from this person? Yeah? It's $4 for a small candle. Now, if you only sold one candle all day, you'd have $4. What if you sold two candles? How much money would you make?
Eight.
And how'd you figure that out?
4 plus 4.
All right, let's bump it up to say 20 candles. How would you figure out how much you made? Yeah? Yeah, so we don't want to add 4 plus 4 plus 4 plus 4 plus 4 plus 4 plus 4 20 times. So we'll just say the money that you make from the small candles is the cost per candle times how many of them did you sell? You sold 5, 4 times 5. You sold 7, 4 times 7. And now, based on that, anyone think they can tell me how you would figure out how much money you make from large candles? You got to take into account the cost of the large candle and how many large candles you sell. We don't know how many we sell, but we do have a letter for it. Yeah. 6Y, yes. This is the cost per candle, and that Y is how many we sell. And we know that we made a total of $144. So there's our first equation. And now we need our second equation. And I think I might just have you set these up because the problem is going to be that's a pretty big number. So if we go to graph this, if you have to graph something that has 144, I mean, you're going to be way off your graph. So it's kind of a big number. So maybe we'll just get Y by itself here, and we'll finish it with the graphing calculator. And in the future, I'll make sure the numbers aren't that big. Okay, so that's this piece of information right here. What I just put a box around, you're done with. Now we have to look at the second equation. You sell 4 more large candles than small. Okay. Let me word that a little different. The number of large candles that you sell is equal to 4 more than the number of small candles. So let's see if we can translate that into letters. What's the number of large candles that we sold? How did we represent how many larges we sold? Yep. Y. Y equals 4 more than. If you want to increase something by 4, what do you write down? Yep. That's quadrupling. If you multiply by 4, we want to just increase it by 4. Yeah? Right, we're going to need a plus 4. Or 4 plus, same thing. So the number of large is 4 more. 4 more than what? The number of large candles that we sold is 4 more than something. Yeah? Four more than the number of small, yeah, which is x. So the number of large candles is 4 more than the number of small candles. So here are the two equations that we would set up. Now, which equation there is already all set? We don't have to do anything to it. Yeah, equation 2 is fine. Let's take a quick look at equation 1. From the warm-up, can somebody tell me my first step there to get x by itself? Yeah? So when you're trying to get the y by itself, we don't want to do anything with the 6y. We want to leave that one alone. Right. The first thing you want to do is subtract 4x from both sides. And that gives me 6y. Equals negative 4x plus 144. Now we want to do something with the 6y. Yeah? Divided by how much? 6. Okay, and I know that reduces. I'm not worried about it. I'm just going to leave it. Y equals negative 4 over 6x plus 144 over 6. Okay, now, let me type that into the calculator and see if I can figure out where these two lines cross. So this is the part you would normally do by hand. The number is too big. I don't want to do it by hand. So let's just wrap this up with the calculator. So negative 4, 6, x, and my y-intercept is 144 over 6. Okay, that's the first one. And the second equation was y equals 4 plus x. So you're about to see it's going to go way off the screen, I think. All right, well, there's the one that's y equals 4 plus x. I can't even see the other one. It's so far up here. So what I'm going to do is set my screen so I can see higher. Okay, well, now I can see it. But am I going to be able to see where they cross? Yeah. Nope, not quite. So not only was it off the screen too high, it's off the screen to the right. This would have been a really, really hard one to graph by hand. So I think now it'll be perfect. You'll be able to see where they cross. Right, so let's pretend that you drew these lines on your own graph paper because they weren't as big as they were. So you've got your two lines. What do you have to figure out once you draw your lines? You want to know what? Yeah? Where they cross. So this is the part where you'd look at your graph paper and hopefully you'd be able to see the answer easily. Well, I'm going to use the calculator. Okay, so you do get a nice answer. It says x is 12 and y is 16. What was x again? X was how many of what type of candle? Small. So this means we sold 12 small candles and Y was large candles. Now, could you have done it by hand? Maybe. But the problem is you would have needed a pretty big piece of graph paper. So I'll make sure the numbers don't get that big in the next problem. So that's how you solve a system by graphing. And you probably already see one reason why graphing is not the best way to do this. Big numbers are really hard to do. So we need to talk about something besides graphing where big numbers aren't an issue. Okay, so worksheet is on Schoology, section 5.1. We'll take a look at that. First thing, well, tomorrow if we have class. If we don't have class, this will be due on Wednesday.